A funny thing happened on the way to this recording. My foot caught the microphone cord that's connected to the computer. It pulled the computer off its stand, and it fell. The phone that's connected is charging. It fell. The computer ended up hitting a vase, and the vase of water came out and got water on the keyboard. It was upside down, fortunately. Another vase that it's standing on was rolling and about to fall on the ground and smash. And so I saw it. I instantly reacted so fast, and I caught that. I stopped that. I picked the computer up, and everything came a cropper, but nothing happened. I put it. It's all back together now. And it's all functioning as far as I know. I don't know about the keyboard if it's working. But that was like a near total disaster in almost every possible way. And it just happened like that. Just like that. It was meant to happen. And so I could see, you know, maybe what my reactions would be. And all the training I've done enabled me to have balance and react quickly and get it back all right, just like that. So, wow, this is, so it's a harbinger of what's to come. So, indeed, welcome to this video. And we are getting extremely intense right now, as we should. But don't worry, it's good. Remember, like in a physical, if you're working out, exercising physically, you want to get to the point where you have like jelly legs, okay, or whatever you're doing. If it hurts, it's working. If it hurts, it works, as they say. If it hurts, it works. So we want to get to this wow in what we're doing. Always we want to get to the wow. It's a workout here. What we're doing is a workout, spiritual workout, super positivity workout. So, of course, you're going to be gassed, but you know, oh, wow. But it's a good feeling, right? Because later on you say, wow, I did it. So, go into it understanding that the wow will arise. You will be just, oh, I don't know if I can take any more kind of thing, but that's what we aim for. Absolutely, that's what we aim for. So, the dream I had of the lady in red is very, 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 very important. And of course, we know that the lady in red is also Illuminati symbol, and it's also the symbol of Vajrayogini, which it is said historically that if Vajrayogini appears to you, it's the highest kind of appearance, and that she only appears to the very, very most fortunate ones. So it's a very interesting situation. There are different ways to look at it, but I can say that the evidence is already stacking up in a positive direction, that it seems as though she may be working to block the Illuminati's agenda for those who have done a lot of spiritual work. Okay, this is what it seems to, and this is historically what it said what she does. I found some websites that go into it and explain it, and it's really quite extremely profound. Keep in mind that all grace comes from the Holy Spirit, okay? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. All grace comes from the Holy Spirit. Now, in Christianity, we're just used to saying it's just the Holy Spirit and the grace of the Holy Spirit. Although, in Catholicism, they take various aspects of grace and sort of personify it for us. It sort of helps us relate to it. And then in Protestantism, of course, they got rid of that. They said it was gone too far with some of the cults of the Virgin Mary cult and a lot of the cults of the saints and relics, etc., etc., etc. Now, Protestants may have gone too far, actually. They both may have gone too far. The correction may have gone too far as well. So we have to keep this in mind. Now, in the Eastern religions, they tend to have these deities, which are really just aspects of God's grace, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit works in different ways depending on your receptivity, Okay, so there isn't just some monolithic, this is the way, you know. No, Holy Spirit's very pragmatic. So what those in the East discovered, and really those in the West too, is the grace works in different ways depending on where you're at, what your patterns of attention are, and all of that. So in the East, they take these various aspects of grace and work with it and seem to specialize for a while on this or specialize on this and specialize. And it gets pretty confusing. So it's like Protestantism is kind of like a nice refuge from all this, perhaps overdoing all this complexity of anthropomorphication. But again, the correction was intended to ground us, you know, away from too much complexity. But the correction shouldn't be taken as an end in itself. This is, I think, the part of the trouble we're experiencing is you go overboard this way, and then in order to correct that, you get really severe the other way. But that other way is overly severe, and it shouldn't be taken an end in itself. It should kind of be like the Buddha said, the middle way, the middle path. Don't overdo it either way, actually. So Vajrayogini comes from Vajradhara or Vajrasattva, is basically God the Father in Eastern religions. Dzogchen call it Samantabhadra, but basically it got replaced later on with Vajradhara. This is God the Father. And then they say that there are various emanations of grace from this, and Vajrayogini would they say is sort of the mother of all Buddhas. So it's a type of grace that is sort of like the mother grace that gives rise to all the different Buddhas and quality, in other words, qualities of grace. And they say you have to be very far along before she'll contact you, before you come in contact with her. Otherwise, it just won't happen. Because now she, her what this grace does is it really takes extreme action in terms of shutting the door on the flesh, identifying with the flesh, identifying with form, identifying with what? Positivity. Keep in mind, positivity is the ugly face of negativity. And I emphasize that. It's really the ugly face of arrogance. It's really the ugly face. We think it's pretty. It's not. It's ugly. It's very ugly. Because what it's doing is it's camouflaging arrogance. And what could be more ugly than that, actually? So positivity is a defense of arrogance. And so positivity and super positivity are not connected really in any way. They're both denying the other. Super positivity has no connection with arrogance, actually, whereas positivity is totally a defense of arrogance. So people might ask you, well, can you tell me something really positive? No. I mean, is there some sort of positivity that isn't the ugly face of arrogance? No, there is not. It all is the ugly face of arrogance. The capacity to speak this way comes from a lot of training towards and in super positivity. And so because I have all this training, it's possible that Vajrayogini has appeared to me and taken my hand and is training me. Now, the first thing I suddenly became aware of, and she's known, she's actually the deity of trauma. And when the world is about to go into trauma, this is when she shows up and is most active. And I say the world's about to go into trauma. Just like this computer whole thing just about came crashing down right now. The world is about to enter into this trauma phase. As a horizon, event horizon is about to take place. And so this is when you would expect this highest aspect of the Holy Spirit, of God's grace, to come into the world in a powerful way. Now, there are Indian sages and Tibetan sages and Chinese sages and et cetera, and probably Christian sages with the Virgin Mary seen in the right context, which it's gotten distorted and twisted completely out of shape. But there are those who understand this. The mother of God, so to speak, is the mother of these various graces. Okay, the mother of the Buddha, they call her Vajrayogini, the mother of all Buddhas, so to speak. But we're talking about the Holy Spirit, actually. Okay, so let's not get lost on the anthropomorphication. and labels. And these are just convenient crutches we're using. Okay. Ultimately, we don't need the crutches, but they're just crutches. So you say the Virgin Mary, that, you know, that we're using some crutches there. Vajrayogini, we're using some crutches, but they're very helpful crutches. And I read this very detailed explanation of Vajrayogini. I said, wow, sounds very much like the Virgin Mary, actually, in classical Christianity, true Christianity, and not the earth goddess nonsense of the pagan stuff that has crept into Christianity and now it's really seems to be ruling the day. This is not what we're talking about. And we're not talking about the physical mother of Jesus. They're talking about an aspect of God's of grace, okay, that can be very, very helpful when trauma is very severe and you need to take drastic steps. And so the first thing I came upon after meeting Vajrayogini, who was here to save us from this terrible trauma that's coming, that's trying to pull us into a venomous attitude and blind us to super positivity. Keep in mind, this world is 100% pretense. Okay, we're all pretending. We're pretending to be bodies, we're pretending to be alive, we're pretending to be sick, we're pretending to die, we're pretending everything here. It's merely pretending 100%. Everything is intentional here. Nothing happens by chance or happenstance. Okay? So, what she did is, she took one moment. Okay, a little interruption. What she did is she started taking these drastic steps, but I was ready for them. And these steps have been taken in like Vajrayana Buddhism. I have heard of this, actually. You know, those ones that were really very highly advanced would often practice in charnel grounds where the corpses were brought to be burned or to be eaten by animals or something. I mean, it's just, you know, and that's one of the, those were many of the greatest sages actually were practiced there. This is a very, very advanced practice. You have to be very advanced to handle this. And you have to see it in the super positivity of it all, that it's breaking your habit of attraction to the flesh. The flesh is terrible, actually. It's death. And I know I'm going to get to what is this practice. You have to lead up to it. The dream I had about joining the Beach Boys, there's two ways of looking at it. One, it's joining the band of positivity. The Beach Boys are all about positivity. And I can say this from very much firsthand experience to the ultimate extent, that when hang your star upon positivity, base your happiness on that, you are headed for depression. You are headed for severe depression. And so the Beach Boys were maybe one of the most positive aspects of the last 50, 60 years or any time. I don't know any musical sound that sounds as good as the full-on Beach Boy harmonies and when they're singing with the reverb chamber and the recording that they had is like a horn section in an orchestra or something, but it's better. It sounds even better. It's just amazing positivity. And the whole California scene at that time was like the height of positivity, maybe in the history of the world. The sun and the fun, the girls on the beach, the hot rods, the Corvettes, just cruising up the coast of California and sun-drenched, you know, it's just automatic. The music, I mean, the scene, it was just, you know, everything was sun-kissed and people were in this massively positive mood at the time. But it all went bad and the result was just, for me, severe depression. Hideous depression. So again, positivity is really the ugly face of arrogance, and behind it lies super negativity, terrible negativity, terrible depression. It is the trap of all traps. So having been through that whole trap, I know exactly what I'm talking about. I'm authority on this. Unfortunately, I learned the hard way, the tough way, the brutal way. So when you say join the Beach Boys, is this a trap? Or was it a play on words? mean the Beach Boys, the boys on the beach, and the beach sand, and the flipping the script that I had just done, which says that sand comes first, then comes the rocks. In our imagining of this world, it started out with fragmentation and death and impermanence and all this, and then it worked its way back to what symbolized permanence. Okay, but it started with the sand and then worked its way back to the rocks. The rocks symbolize permanence, whereas the sand symbolizes, of course, impermanence, because that's a wearing away of the rocks. But the dream started with the sand. It didn't start with the rocks. We have it backwards, you see, in the world. We have it backwards. Nobody's really looked at this, actually. We just assume it started with the rocks. But if it's a dream, and it is a dream, it's the dream started, the purpose of it all started with the sand. So a beach boy is somebody who knows this key fact about this dream, that it started with the impermanence, it started with the fragmentation. And so in that way, if I joined the Beach Boys, I would be joining a band of those who knew the truth. So you could look at it two different ways, just like you look at the lady in red in two different ways. But there's evidence that the lady in red is Vajrayogini. There's a lot of evidence starting to build up. But I'm checking things. I certainly am. So what she did is she said, okay, well, I'm gonna break your attraction to the flesh, because this is what is coming in the world. When you get the traumas that are coming, you're going to leap into the arms of the flesh, special relationships, romantic relationships, all that kind of stuff, and try to take refuge in those. And she actually pointed this out to me in a certain way. I became aware of this, and it's really extraordinary what happens to your mind. It's like, what in the heck? I thought I was free of all that stuff. No, we're not. It doesn't matter how spiritual you are. If you get hit with enough trauma, you will find your mind, you know, falling in love, turning to romance, going back to the flesh, and taking refuge in that, just out of the massive, massive, massive habit that we've been up against. And you will be very surprised about this, but I'm warning you, I have experienced this firsthand. I know what I'm talking about now. So, enter Vajrayogini. What did she do? She said, okay, look at that yoga girl there. Then they're swarming all over the place here. I mean, you can't go anywhere. I mean, I was in line at the hardware store today, and this just uber yoga girl was moving all around the store real quick, and then she got in line right behind me. And I said, uh-oh. And then I decided I'm going to get out of this line and go to another cashier, because another cashier suddenly opened up. And there's a real down-home girl there, you know, opposite of a yoga girl. And I went over to her and got out of that store. It's got grace of God. But this was this uber aggressive yoga girl. And so they are absolutely getting ready for this trauma that's coming in the world to act as magnets, okay? Magnets. This has been done throughout history. Everyone's aware of what's coming, really, and there are many, many, many people, women in particular, prepared to survive and thrive as attracting, you know, the uber males, the alpha dog males and stuff to them, and then they end up becoming, you know, the new aristocracy, the new power players, etc. So there's a huge, huge getting readiness. I mean, I was working out recently, and the place was swarming with yoga girls, and they were working out like crazy. Let me tell you, they were just hitting it almost as hard as the guys. I mean, there were some male athletes there that were just ridiculous. But the women, holy cow, I am telling you, they are preparing big time, because they know that in a super trauma, everybody goes looking for the arms of the beautiful mother, so to speak, the beautiful flesh. Where is it? And romance will strike you. Cupid will strike you. Just extraordinarily. You would not think you've gone crazy. Literally, you think you've gone crazy. You're falling in love again. But just out of desperation, out of a sense of trauma. Okay? It's really dangerous situation. So, Vajrayogini said, look at that yoga girl. Okay? Or just imagine, okay, so imagine a yoga girl. And then she said, imagine her breasts are all full of pus, horrible, horrible pus. And that's what that's what's coming out of me, just this sickening pus. And I, ah! You know, just like, it hit me like, ah! Like a shock, you know. I said, holy cow, that's horrible. And the mental picture that came just shocked me. And she's done it over and over and over and over again. Every time it's a yoga girl, I just imagine that horrible pus. And then she imagined the teeth, all the nice teeth, rotting teeth, sick pus is coming out of the teeth. And so every part of their attractiveness, she says, imagine this. And she gives me this shocking image that really, I jump back like, pow! God, that's horrible. It's kind of like, what is it, that stuff that people used to drink, alcoholics would drink something that when they took a drink of alcohol, it just like tasted like hideous to them. They just spit it out. It was awful. Now, this is pretty, you know, strong treatment. It's very strong treatment, but it's super effective, actually. So the very notion of turning my mind in any way towards romance, that's horrible. That's horrible. And this is like the what they used to do in the charnel grounds, is they kept training themselves every time their mind started to wander towards a special relationship. The image of these rotting corpses, they just just absolutely gross them out, and it just shit, you know, just so mental aversion. You develop this aversion to the flesh. Actually, this is what Vajrayogini is known for, is helping develop an aversion to the flesh. It's like shock treatment, actually. And I welcomed, I said, wow, that's very helpful. Thank you very much. That's super helpful. And I can see that it's necessary, because I can see no matter how much we prepare, we still within us jump into the arms of the flesh if things get shocking bad enough. Okay? This is what I've discovered. And so you need aversion therapy, some type of aversion therapy. The Tibetans, Tibetans are very good at this, where you go through and you imagine every, you know, attractive element, like of a female or a male, if you're a yogini, a male, whatever you're attracted to, every attractive element, you visualize it in a hideous way that is just repulsive, just absolutely creeps out. And here's another one. If you see a yoga girl approaching, the sound is that like a rattlesnake. I just heard a rattlesnake. There is no creepier sound I've ever heard in my life than that rattlesnake. I mean, it just penetrates to your nerves, all the way to the center of your nerves, and you just start, and you just say, whoa, I'm not going near that place. So just imagine, Vajrayogini said, imagine there's this seemingly beautiful yoga girl, and what you hear is the sound of a rattlesnake. That just unnerves me. Another thing, imagine her hands to be like poison oak. So wherever she touches you, you get this horrible rash, horrible itchy rash. Okay? So these are super advanced practices right now, and hopefully I'm not breaking Samaya talking about this, but we need to look at this, and this practice may come to you as well, and you may need it. I'm telling you that you may need this practice. And again, women use the same thing with men. You know, whatever seems to be so wonderful to them, just allow something that just absolutely creeps you out, and start identifying with that. You know, that whenever your mind goes in that direction, imagine wherever they touch you, shingles. You know, you get the shingles or the hives. I guess you call them the hives. I mean, it's just horrible itching. It's just hideous. And whatever, you know, the pus thing in the breast, not breast milk, it's horrible pus. That just, gah, that is just horrible. But, yeah, I said, fantastic. What a great, skillful technique this is, actually. And we are going to need it. We are going to need this. And, you know, it's too bad our arrogance has led us into this crazy dream, but it has. And we need skillful means to get out of it. if they have this beautiful hair, you know, beautiful blonde hair, you'll grow blonde. Imagine it's all these like you know, rattlesnakes in her hair, and that when she moves, there's all the hissing and rattling. When playing with her hair, it's, you hear the rattling of a rattlesnake, and it's just almost like just leap back, you know, like, oh, abhorrence, repulsion, abhorrence. And this is exactly what historically Vajrayogini is said to have done with those who are very far along on the path, who would take this in the right way. So this is literally what happened. So this is very compelling evidence that she's on the case now, which means it's getting very close. Now, keep in mind, I've had dreams over the last several months of Sri Sri Nanamaya Ma saying she is here, she's on the case, and she is ready to start helping out big time. Well, Nanamaya Ma was, you could say, incarnation of Vajrayogini, the ultimate emanation of grace, you might say, in terms of practical effectiveness. But how she worked, it was just a certain way. She's not limited to the way she appeared in India. She's not limited to that by any means. But in a crisis, you expect the heavyweights to show up. And keep in mind who's been showing up. Jesus Christ has showed up. Ramana Maharshi has showed up. Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma has showed up. And Longchenpa, the omniscient Dharma King Longchenpa, has showed up. And now Vajrayogini has showed up. You can't get any more heavyweight than this. So this indicates that there is a crisis that is coming, and what happens is you lurch back into super. What happens is you the negativity is so bad, you become desperate for positivity. Something to cool that beast, you know, that it's like a ferocious rash. You know, you just stop this rash, this is horrible. And you start applying positivity to it. And then you get addicted to this positivity, but that is the whole game that is being played. And then that's pulled out from underneath you, and then you plunge into depression. You plunge into depression. This is what I know, this is what I can vouch for, is what happens. It's like a beautiful woman seducing a man and getting him addicted to sex, and until the man is just craving it all the time, and then suddenly she leaves like that. And so the man has this craving, or a drug addiction or something like that. You get hooked on the drug and remove it, and then the craving is so bad that the person just goes out of their mind, and then they start making all these bad decisions. That's then when you start going down the road of depression, is when you have a craving that's not being fulfilled, and you start making very bad decisions. Like, you get hooked on a drug, the drug pusher then removes it. Okay, the drug pushers know how to do this. They give you free drugs to start out with. They hook you in various ways. Give you free drugs, then cheap drugs, and they say, "Wow, look! I mean, it's cheap. It's first it's free, then it's cheap. You're having such great times, and like your life's just a positive thing, isn't it? It's all positive now." And then, oops, they suddenly make it scarce. They're suddenly scarce, and you can't find them. And then you start feeling this craving, and you start getting frantic. You say, "Where's the pusher? Where's the pusher?" And then the pusher says, "Oh, you know, I've had a real tough time, like." My supply, you know, ran out, and I can't get any more supply. It's really difficult. Demand is tightened up suddenly. That this is just a classic thing they do, and they say, "Well, what do you mean?" And I say, "Wow, it's really expensive. I don't even think I could afford it. I'm paying a fortune for this stuff now." It was a big bust down the border, and this blah 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 blah. And so they give you this line about, you know, how the supply is dried up, therefore the price is skyrocketed. Okay, then they've got you, you see. And then you say, well, I've got to find some way to pay for this. And then they start hooking you into crime, okay? And they start making a slave out of you and start pulling you down into lose your dignity, into severe depression, okay? This is how it works. Very vicious. The ego is very vicious, okay? And Vajrayogini knows how vicious it is. Therefore, she takes these countermeasures, you know, the pus countermeasure. And since I know how vicious the ego is, I welcome the pus countermeasure. I say, "Thank God, thank you very much. That's very, very helpful. We need that." So when there's a trauma and you go to turn to positivity, there's all these clever users who are waiting to pounce on this and get you addicted to positivity. And then they will start making themselves scarce, hook you into desperation, and then start enslaving you. This is how it works. For their own aggrandizement, their own riches, you know, so they can, yeah, be greater than you. And this world is a nasty, nasty place, and that's putting it very mildly. And if you've been through all of this, which I certainly have, you realize just how terrible it is, just how what a hardball game is played here. And therefore, we're absolutely within our rights to play hardball back at it, right back at your dream, right back at your arrogance, right back at your ego. You want to play hardball? Meet Miss Vajrayogini, okay? Yeah, okay. That's her game too. So this is, again, we are marching along. I mean, you're probably viewing this on the 20th, and the 27th is just around the corner. And we are determined to go turn to super positivity instead of positivity. Super positivity is where it's at. It is not just some sort of like, let's listen to the Beach Boys all day sort of thing. Okay, this is where we get trapped into positivity, okay? We think, oh, the Beach Boys are so positive, the music's so positive, or it just sounds so great. And you think, okay, well, it doesn't quite work, but so the answer is more of it. So let me just sit in my room all day and listen to it 24 hours a day, you know, day after day after day after day after day. And this is what happens when we get into positivity. We want more and more and more and more of it. Okay. As if quantity is the quality. It'll somehow change the quality of it. This is a trap. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. This is really, really troublesome. Doesn't matter how much time you spend with positivity, it never translates into super positivity. Super positivity is only comes from a repentant mind, and what it is glimpses of reality, of truth. The fact that we are all innocent, entirely innocent, 360 degree innocence is what we need to practice. Not you are innocent and you are innocent, not 280 degree innocence, the rest is not innocent, but 360 degree innocence. And I had a dream just recently where it was like almost like a lucid dream, you have to call it. And I was in this place. I said, whoa, wow, this is really nice, a very great feeling. I had this great feeling, and I said, but I don't recognize the place. And then I said, yeah, but I know how to deal with this spiritually. It's okay. How do I keep this feeling? And then I started to struggle a little bit. And what is the answer to this? How do you just feel perfectly okay wherever you are in this place? You might find yourself, where am I? I don't know, but I feel perfectly okay. And the answer is 360 degree innocence. That's where I am. I'm in 360 degree innocence. That's where I always am. No matter how hard we try, and God knows we've tried to our utmost, we can never get free of our innocence. Okay, we can never leave it. It's impossible. Nothing has ever happened. Nothing can or will ever happen. We are free. We are absolutely free. And that is our innocence. Everyone is free. Perfectly free. So everything we experience is our own choice. 100%. God is this perfect freedom. Actually, this is what God is. This is what we are. This is what all is. So I'm in 360 degree innocence is a super positive statement. Okay? Very different than positivity, isn't it? Positivity tries to select certain thing and say, okay, this is really positive and this is blocking out the other negative stuff. That doesn't work. What we're saying is, I am abiding in 360 degree innocence. 360 degree innocent inclusiveness. Innocent inclusiveness. 360 degree innocent inclusiveness. And there's the wow. So the wow is a corollary, the real wow, not the wow that comes with positivity, which is, that's a different thing. And you can differentiate between the two. The sex, the drugs, the rock and roll of positivity tries to develop some sort of wow, like you think this is really it or something. But it's is kind of like drinking a diet soft drink or something. You could taste the aftertaste, right? It's like, wow, that's a fake. That's fake. That's a fake sweetener, right? You could taste, it's not quite cane sugar, you know, right? So the same thing with the real wow. You can feel the burn. You can feel, wow, this is it. This is the real wow. This is a burn. Wow, I am just, the whole landscape has just shifted on me. Wow, that's the real thing. And the other stuff is fake. It's fake, like a fake Louis Vuitton handbag or something. Fake something. It's fake. It's fake. It's a clever fake, but it's a fake. Okay, and it will hook you like a drug into positivity, and then the rug will be pulled out from underneath you. That's how it's done, and you plunge into depression. And when you plunge into depression, you try to pull yourself out through positivity, and you already know that doesn't work. It led you into it. And so you just feel like there's no way out. There's no solution to you whatsoever. And then you start thinking about suicide. And it's just hell. Depression can become absolute hell. Living hell, a walking living hell, because you don't know the way out. And the way out of depression is super positivity, okay? 100% certain, I'm telling you this authoritatively, the way out of depression is super positivity. There is no other way out of it, really, okay? You can take drugs, you can take medicines and therapy and such, and, you know, try to take the edge off of the depression a little bit. You're still vulnerable to that depression. It's still like it's lurking there, okay? It's lurking there. Depression for me is not really lurking there. I have for a long, long time, I don't feel it lurking. Used to be like it was lurking everywhere. It's horrible. Imagine just living your life where you feel this hideous depression is around every corner, lurking. It could be anywhere. Because that's what happens. Suddenly, your positivity fails you, and poof, you're plunged back into it like that. But you take the path of super positivity, and it's not lurking anywhere. It's not really lurking anywhere. Potentially, you could say, of course it's possible, of course. It's not right now, but maybe later. Okay, yeah. I mean, that, and of course, we're vulnerable to being pulled back into positivity, which would then lead back to depression, absolutely. So we have to go with super positivity. Okay, so this video is telling it like it is, and it's very serious here. If any of you knows what depression is like, and severe depression, you know that what we're talking about here is very, very serious, ultimately serious. And we have so much positivity in the world right now. People are so used to the good life that when the rug gets pulled out from under you, we're talking about depression on a global scale mentality. The whole mentality of the globe could go into depression, and then it begins clutching at straws. Or first it gets clutching at straws, and then it goes into depression. And out of that, you get those who want to control and enslave, and like the drug pusher, and that says, well, we'll give you a little bit of the drug, but you got to do what I tell you to do, and you have to be enslaved, okay, enslaved. So it is a very, very dangerous situation in the world right now. And people will turn to one another to try to cure through the special relationship, through the flesh. And, I live in an area where there's more fat cats than any place in the world, especially gold diggers and women. There's just the whole place is just gold diggers. I mean, they are so used to being pampered and taken care of. And when the trouble comes, they are just going to be up a creek without a paddle. And they expect men to bow to get on their knees and worship them. And this is the card that they will try to play. And when you get a bunch of desperate men also at the same time, you're looking at going into some very, very bad territory, actually. and getting into, you know, positive goddess worship and all this kind of stuff. And then you become so enslaved and dependent on that. And then they start to pull the rug out from underneath you. And then you taste depression. And then that's when you're willing to really try and enslave your mind and become a mind slave. So it gets worse and worse and worse as you get more and more desperate. Because they want perpetual enslavement, they think, is the only answer. In other words, more positivity, endless positivity, which they see you, whichever way you want to look at it, the one that's getting enslaved, is just a slave labor for forever. Maintenance work, slave labor. You know, all the dirty, nasty stuff of this world has to be done, and I've done all of it. So I know what I'm talking about. I've lived through it all. If there's some nasty job that has to be done, I've probably done it. I was pulling weeds today, as a matter of fact. I did a whole bunch of nasty jobs today. A lot. So they believe that just having you do that for them, taking care of all little troubles, whatever it is that bothers them, forever and ever and ever and ever and ever, is the only answer. So they want to have you a mental slave. A mental slave. That you feel you cannot get free from this. And just the click of the fingers, and there's all these ways of training, like training a dog. You see a lot of yoga girls, they have dogs, and they train them. And they're totally into to learning how to condition the dogs. All they got to do is just a look or a one command, and poof, the dog immediately reacts. They're very much into behavioralism, okay? And viewing males, and also the flip side, okay? If you're a woman listening to this, the flip side, of course there's a flip side too. And you can look at it the same way. Okay, conditioning like Barbie dolls to get a command like that. But generally speaking, the women are much more clever than the men, okay? So that doesn't happen as much as people think. The woman's usually, you know, is able to flip the script in some way. But you know what I'm talking about is behavioralism and conditioned reflexes, where you try to condition the nervous system as such and the psyche so that they're like a robot, basically. And what, you know, the age-old question, what do women really want? The answer is they want robots. So they think they can, you know, find this positivity will work. Well, positivity, again, is just the defense of arrogance. And arrogance will never work, because arrogance is the belief that we can change reality. And only by changing reality will we be happy. This is what arrogance tells us. Arrogance just made this up. It just said, happiness only comes from changing the happiness that we have. Well, where did that come from? It came from what's called arrogance. Arrogance is just to make something up out of thin air and claim that this is the new truth. So arrogance said, the new truth about happiness is you can only be happiness by changing the happiness that you already have. That's the only way you can be happy now. Well, God didn't say this. And God created reality, and God, it says it's unchangeable. So we cannot just come in and change it. So when we try to change it this way, it's just arrogance. And this is exactly what we did. We came in, Spirit said, okay, now there's a new reality, and that is the only way to be happy is to change the old happiness. And the ability to change it is our new happiness. This is what we tell ourselves. This is arrogance, and it's a total lie. It's nothing but a lie. But this is what we're hooked on. So use an example, a good example that probably you could become aware of. I mean, wherever you live, you can see that the yoga girl thing has got a different spin where you live, okay? But you get the picture of what's going on, because it's going on all over the world, actually. All over the world. And there are these people who are getting ready for the trauma and to exploit it in a delusional way. And also, of course, women have to perpetuating the bodies, the race, they're the ones who have to give birth. So they want to survive. You know, they think, well, we can sacrifice the men, but not the women. Okay, so this is and men are going along with this, basically. They're saying, yeah, okay, if we have to die, so be it. But the women know that we can't die. They got to keep them going. So the women are really coming very tough. Tough-minded, like survivalist, and ruthless, very ruthless. It's a very different story. I bumped into this elder lady in the store. I turned around. We got bumped, and she just goes, "Oh, excuse me." I said, "Excuse me," and she's just like, you know, totally took it in stride, and it was no problem. She was, I don't know, maybe she's like 80 or 75 or 80 or something. Just you know, elderly lady, but different, completely different generation. And she understood that it was just this. You know, inadvertence, but of course nothing happens by chance, so that was meant to happen just to show the difference that now with the yoga girls, how if you happen to bump into them, the aggression, which I did bump into one of my vehicle tap, wow, did I get, it revealed the attitude, which was, is that you're a robot and you're going to do exactly what I tell you to do. I'm in charge here. And I said, no, you're not. What I really was saying, Holy Spirit's in charge here. Dharma Kings are in charge here, okay? They're in charge of my life. I don't know who's in charge of your life. That's your problem. I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit's in charge of my life. So you're not telling the Holy Spirit what to do, okay? But she just flipped out. Couldn't handle that. Absolutely could not handle that. So very, very different scenario taking place here, okay? The younger generation's a whole different thing. So, here we go. We just keep breathing. We're working out here. We're getting a very intense workout, and hopefully this computer is going to keep working. That just about spoiled the party right there, didn't it? This was meant to be also to show me what's going to happen. Now, does this mean that we're suddenly going to lose electronics suddenly? It's possible. Electronics might fail. What would cause that? Well, severe coronal mass ejection would cause it. That an EMP, severe EMP of some sort, could cause it. There might be some weapons been developed that can cause it. But if you get enough charged particles from the sun or a gravity wave, severe gravity wave could be coming in from the center of the galaxy, or a supernova could suddenly show up in this world. Keep in mind, you don't see supernovas coming. They're putting these various satellites and probes are trying to put them as far out as possible now. Why? Well, they say we're looking at Pluto or doing this, blah blah blah. But what I think is their early warnings, early detection systems for supernovas. Some of them, because of course a supernova will be traveling at the speed of light, and the gravity wave might be a little slower, might be lagging behind it actually. There are cosmic effects from massive supernovas, and we know that this can affect us here. So the speed of light, I don't know how fast it takes to get from Pluto to the Earth light. Pretty fast, probably. Yeah. 186,000 miles a second. I don't know how far Pluto is. How many hundreds of millions of miles or something. So it might take, I don't know, it takes a little while to get here. And then we may have probes farther out than they tell us, actually. Which may be a signal to the elite, like when they notice a supernova or something coming in, head for the bunkers, underground bunkers. Gravity wave could knock out the electricity, but a coronal mass ejection from the sun could build up too many charged particles and just fry the whole grid, just fry it. Could knock out the satellites, could knock out the microchips, could knock out our whole electronic system, could be knocked out. Well, yeah, that is very possible. Who knows if that could just suddenly happen? Now, if you're used to a simple life and contemplating truth, you've got your books still, right? You've got all your techniques here. Full stop in the wow techniques, you have that, this great practice. You can practice this, doesn't matter if electricity goes out or anything. You can just keep sailing right on smoothly and just say, wow, this actually even helps my practice by recognizing what's going on in the world. I see how important my practice is. So you're not without what you need, you have what you need. You have the Holy Spirit with you. The Holy Spirit, the grace, and you have the Dharma Kings, right? And you can call upon them for any and all miracles, actually. And you can work on empowering them. So you have this massive grab bag of techniques that we've given out here. and more will occur to you. And so you're blessed. You're blessed. Whereas the gold diggers and though all those have gotten very comfortable, which is most people in the world, are sort of easing into this materialism, like, wow. Well, suddenly the prospect of that is just like disappeared off the face of the map. And what do you think their mental state is going to be like? Well, what are they going to go for? Sex, drugs, and rock and roll, of course. To try and calm their minds down, try to get positivity back in their lives. This is what people used to do. We've got so sophisticated in materialism now. We don't realize, and beneath the surface, we have all these addictions to the flesh, and that we can easily turn back to those addictions in the face of some sort of loss of material prosperity. You know, what if the whole stock market crashes and fiat money collapses and people lose all their retirement, all their money, everything's gone? What are they going to return to? What are they going to return to? What are they going to do? Stop it from going crazy, going insane, just losing their minds as far as just despair and depression. Well, first comes despair, and then the struggle to medicate the despair. So they're going to try and medicate the despair. What are the remedies, the remedies that humanity has used to medicate despair throughout history? Sex, drugs, and music, rock and roll, okay? And all the various accoutrements of that, okay, which can be elaborated to just endless extents, really. But this is what humanity has always used. So we think we've left that behind. We haven't left it behind. This is what I found out. We have not left it behind. What we have right now is very superficial veneer. And as long as the gravy train keeps going, we think we're very sophisticated. And no, if we lose that, most people will go back into self-medicating in that way. They don't know how to deal with it in the super positivity way. They simply have not prepared. They have not familiar with it. And they don't even see what it is. They think it's just more positivity, like it's a whole bunch of positivity. You know, super positivity isn't just a larger quantity of positivity. It is a fundamentally different. It is stating the fundamental truth of our being, which is no one's ever been born. We've never been born. There's no such thing as life forms at all. There's no such thing as matter at all. We don't have any needs at all. They're all made up. They're all pretend needs, 100%. Jesus has said this. Every single need, he says, the body is completely made up. Body doesn't have any needs whatsoever. Made up from arrogance and projected upon the body. The body's just neutral. Doesn't have any needs. Sri Sri Ananda, my ma, showcased this for us. She said, this body doesn't have any needs. I don't need to eat, sleep, breathe, use the sensory perception, do anything. I can still function fine. But to freak the people out so bad, she said, okay, let's make a deal. Okay. She said, I'll eat one grain of rice a day then. Okay, if that makes you happy. But it's got to be a very pure grain of rice, and you got to prepare it and all this. So she gave them something to do, so they thought that they were doing something, you know, to make this grain of rice so important that it would, you know, feed her or something. But she said, I don't need to eat. The body doesn't need to eat. The body doesn't need anything, really. She says, actually, body can be completely nourished just from essence. really saying from the mind. From the mind. Didn't need to sleep. Didn't need to use a sensory perception to function. Here, she walked about at night, and she says, what do you mean, what problem do I have? It's pitch dark. What do you mean? She says, everything is as bright as can be. Everything is just light. It says, the sunlight just doesn't make any difference to me whatsoever. I'm not seeing with the sunlight. And so we had this someone in the world that was literally showcasing what Jesus has talked about to the ultimate extent. This is what Jesus tells us. So I found her life to be super, super corroboration with what Jesus has to say. Super proof, super evidence. So it greatly helped my faith in Jesus, because I know somebody was here that verified what he has said and is saying. Didn't need to sleep either. She'd sit there and act like she's sleeping, but she says, actually, I'm totally wide awake, exactly the same as if my eyes are open or closed or mid of the day, whatever. My state never changes. I'm perfectly aware every moment, have complete open awareness to all that needs to be aware of, and it never changes at all. So I don't identify with the body in the slightest bit. My body has nothing to do with what I am. She said, this is just for your sake that I'm showing a body. That's not for my sake at all. I don't need the body at all. So this is exactly what Jesus says. Exactly what Jesus says. So Sri Sri Anandamayi introduced herself to me and gave me the invitation to pay attention to her as a way of helping me with A Course in Miracles. Because A Course in Miracles is so a radical change. It's a different belief system. Entirely, actually. It's not just more positivity, more Christian positivity, which is what Christianity has fallen into, is mere positivity. All right? Even the evangelicals have fallen into this, who used to be more into the miraculous, super positivity. Now they're listening to this prosperity talk. You know, they've fallen into that trap. No, Jesus is bringing super positivity. He always has and always will. And so you need to step out of both Catholicism and Protestantism to get this super positivity. Because both of them have lapsed. Both of them, I'm like a spiritual auditor, I tell you, both of them have lapsed into positivity. And when religion lapses into positivity, you know, where is the love we used to, you know, that song, where is the love? Well, what we really love is super positivity. You know, all these songs, pop songs, they always talk about love. What they mean is positivity and how terrible positivity is. You think, I thought I had it. Where is the love? I had this love and it's gone. Where is the love we used to share so well? Da 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 da. Where is the love? It's all about that. You know, the honky tonk songs that George Jones used to sing so well in the honky tonks of Texas and make the oil men break down in tears because nobody ever sang honky tonk music any, you know, like Jones did. And he just crush you because he's singing about the positivity and what happened to this positivity. It's gone. And now here I am, you know, an empty bottle, a broken heart, and you're still on my mind. And this is exactly what happens. And they'd self-medicated with what? Drugs, alcohol. It's brutal. It's brutal when you rely on positivity and then it pulls the rug out from underneath you. This is designed to crush your spirit. This whole system we have is designed to crush our spirit. To forget about super positivity and say, ah, I can't trust it, you know, no, I can't do it. I'm depressed. I can never get out of this. It's designed to make us so depressed that we can never get out of this depression. And I have absolutely been there. And I was in such bad situation that reached rock bottom. And that's when I asked for help and the Holy Spirit showed up. He says, don't worry, I got this. I'm super positive. Meet super positivity and you're going to get used to this. And once you get used to it, you're never going back to that depression. Guaranteed, you're going to be cured forever. Wow, we got this major climate shift. Our temperature shift is happening from 96 now. It's just plunging, and we're getting storms coming in, and it's like night and day that's changed here very quickly. And I was thinking maybe today I can finally go golf. You know, I haven't golfed in so long. It was this beautiful day, tropical feel to it, and the Holy Spirit said, no, not today. I said, why? Not today. I said, okay, Holy Spirit, you know best. Well, just after the Holy Spirit said that, the winds kicked up, and they kicked up worse and worse and worse, and the clouds came in, and I would have had a miserable time, absolutely miserable. It's getting cold out here, actually, because of the wind chill factor. And it does. So what a change. It was 96 in summertime to yesterday. This shows you just how fast stuff can change and how the Holy Spirit knows what it's talking about. It says, no, don't go get caught into this positivity. You're going to do super positivity. In super positivity, we can do it. We can do it. I've been doing it for quite some time now, long time. It's not that difficult at all. But we can't mix the two, the positivity and super positivity. You got to be very careful of that. Because the positivity always goes towards more, 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 because it doesn't work. And the desperation arises, and cravings arise. So it's a slippery slope, a very slippery slope, is what I've found. So we're praying, we're not praying, we're asserting that we have super positivity here, and that is what we're doing. This is what we're sticking with. This is what works. It absolutely works. And we're going to need this. Vajrayogini is on the scene. She's made her move. 15th, I believe, of May, she made her move. About a year and 15 days after Jesus made his move. Which he said, folks, I'm back as your friend now. And so you're going to have to relate to me through super positivity. That's the only way. I'm not an idol, okay? I'm somebody you have to relate with as a friend. And the only way I relate is through super positivity. So he gave us the heads up a year and 15 days ago. And then after a year and 15 days, Vajrayogini shows up. Now, if you're a Christian and you want to, you can say the Virgin Mary, if you want to say that. But this has to be understood. It's the Virgin Mary as super positivity. It's really the grace of the Holy Spirit as super positivity, not as positivity. And so much of the Virgin Mary cult is a cult of positivity and of matter and of world and of form. And those who are desperate for positivity, they go to her in desperation, say, help, 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 this positivity. I need more, 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 more. Help me, help me, help me, help me. Maybe death, well, they actually plead to die. You go to her and say, help me die. I just got to die. I can't stand this. Despair, I can't stand this. Pray for me in my hour of death. Pray for me in the rosary and all that kind of stuff. This is positivity. This is not the Virgin Mary's super positivity at all. Which will help you break the terrible stranglehold of form and process, the belief in process and form and flesh and worlds and scripts and all this will help break this through you know, shock tactics. And she'll also say, do whatever my son tells you to do. Right? Yeah. Now, I can tell that there's trauma coming just by the yoga girls, the way they're walking now. They're all over the place, and you know that. And the whole play of attraction now is going to come out of the bushes, so to speak. And you start to notice the uptick of this. And then you notice your reactions, and you say, maybe I'll take a look at that. And you realize, hey, why would I be thinking that way? It's because that you know the trauma is coming. You're thinking, you know, how can I be saved from it? How can I be saved from it? But then Vajrayogini steps in and says, yeah, take a look at that pus there and the festering sores with maggots in them. You know, her behind is full of festering sores with maggots in them, eating the flesh. You know, and you're looking at this pretty face. It's actually maggots and rashes and pus and you know, rot. And it just like, I just like, ah! Just, it just, you know, gives me this super shock. So this, we know then that from what we're leading up to, we know that something is coming. It doesn't really matter how the rug is pulled out from under positivity. The problem is the same. It doesn't really matter. So I don't care what happens. I'm not really focused on what happens so much. I just know that the rug is going to be pulled out from positivity. This is what seems to be we're going towards in order to produce this robotic enslavement. And, you know, I see people, they look at it, they think they're going to find it in their smartphone. Okay, this is where all this positivity is. Oh yeah, I'm connected to all this positivity. Don't worry, baby. I'm connected to all this positivity through a smartphone. And so people are just, wherever I go, even all these third world people, they've got smartphones, right? And they think this is the answer. Well, no, this is what's going to lead you into robotic enslavement. Okay, that is why the smartphone, the Holy Spirit told me it is so dangerous, is because people think, well, I can just get more positivity than ever before. I can go online and get all these songs, the music, which is just positivity, endlessly. So I got no problem. As long as I got a smartphone, I got no problem. What me worry? You know, Alfred E. Newman, what me worry? I think everybody's offered like Alfred E. Newman. He thinks they've got it covered. No, I got it covered. The guys and increasingly more of the gals go to pornography, right? Or actually the women go to all the kinky, really weird, sick stuff. They're really into that. The guys are more into just pornography, and the women are into these really sick, twisted stuff. Really twisted stuff. They tend to like that a lot more. And there's just, I guess, endless amounts of that on the internet now, of really perverted, but beyond even what we say is perversion, just really sick stuff. They're really into that. When they go for positivity, that's what they go for. And that's what they want the guys to get into, actually. Now, the guys are saying, no, I just want the basic pinups and stuff like that, cheesecake, the pinups, pornography, that's what I want. And the women, no, you've got to become this really sick slave, you know, and get into this just stuff that's beyond anything that we could hardly even imagine. It's just, you know, rotted filth. But that's what they expect the men to get into. It makes the Marquis de Sade look like a choir boy, you know, and it's the women that are into that. So they think that, oh, I've got, it's some really sick guys who have been enslaved. You can see them. You can tell right away that this is what they're into. They're just, their minds are so warped. The guys are just like these sex slaves and stuff. These sex gods, it's just horrible. But they have a smartphone. They say, oh, we're covered. Any kind of abomination you can imagine, you can find it online. You can find it through a smartphone, right? Yeah, that's true, right? So they think they've got it all covered. Well, what happens when the smartphones don't work? Yeah, just wow that. Just wow that. What happens when smartphones don't work? The computers don't work. Just wow that. And what do you think all these sick women are going to do then? You know, well, you have, you know, Whore of Babylon. The Whores of Babylon is what you're looking at. And they're going to demand, they're going to get super demanding. That this, guys, this is how you have to be, or else off with your head. Yeah, no kidding. We think that we haven't seen anything yet. I guess when you live in the Bay Area, San Francisco, you be more aware of that. I mean, these dames are strutting around in black stiletto heels, and you know, it's just they've all got the whips out. In fact, you see them leading men on leashes now. In San Francisco, like a dog. I mean, they've got a complex going on, okay. But this is beneath the surface throughout the world. Actually, it's beneath the surface throughout the world. The world's been corrupted because we've been shown all these styles of positivity that we're told that's the answer. Well, who's promoting this? We call it the devil, okay, Satan. The devil is promoting all this. If you're more sophisticated a little bit, you call it, you know, the reptilians. The extraterrestrials, reptilians. And if you go deeper, you call it the ego. And if you go even deeper than that, arrogance. Spiritual arrogance, spiritual pride is promoting all this. Saying, we don't need any of the super positivity. We just got all these varieties of positivity. We got the cornucopia of positivity. We have this positivity paradise, which is what the reptilians are turning this world into. They're using this world for their own positivity paradise. But what they don't tell you is, you know, they're into drinking your blood, actually, the reptilians, okay? Blood of children, blood of infants, sacrifice, blood sacrifice they're into, actually. That's where it's going. That's where it's really going. Is it won't be enough pretty soon when the traumas come. You know, it won't be enough just to have sex slaves. They'll be insisting that they cut out your heart. Blood sacrifice. They'll be drinking the blood from your heart, actually. And this has been done in the past, of course, the Aztec culture, I mean, the Mayan, I mean, the various cultures, them all over the world, ancient cultures, blood sacrifice, sacrificing infants, children's, warriors, maidens, virgins, you name it. Okay, all different types, blood sacrifice for this positivity. It really does go there. I'm telling you that the kinky culture of this world right now is headed towards blood sacrifice. Plain and simple. And all it's going to take is a severe enough trauma for this to happen. Now, the lady in red, the Vajrayogini, appears in wrathful aspect, showing you that positivity does lead to blood sacrifice and shocking you about it. She shocks you and says, look at this. You want to have your heart ripped out and be drinking blood? Well, you keep going with positivity. That's what you're going to be doing. It's also, she appears a wrathful way, is she's drinking the blood of everyone's, the bloodlust that people have, this blood that's in them. In other words, it symbolizes this horrible, vicious, you know, positivity that they're going towards this hideousness. She drinks all that and takes it into her body, but it doesn't go any further because surrounding her body is a field of blue with these light rays, beautiful light rays. And so she transmutes all karma. She's able to transmute even this very kinky, bloodlust, hideous, sacrificial stuff. She's able to transmute all of that. And this is necessary in what's coming in the world. You have to have that skillful means to transmute all of that hideousness and shock us away from it. And she is the one who has proven able to do this. When times devolve into the most hideous baseness possible, this is when Vajrayogini shows up. And she might also be called Kali in Hinduism. It's possible that they may be one and the same. You know, you see the skulls on her and all this stuff. What it shows is she goes beneath the surface and to the bones of the situation. Okay, to the absolutely bare bones of the situation. Also, shocking you away from the body by showing you just the bones, the skeleton, you know, the death beneath the superficial cover of, you know, the cosmetics of it all. And so, this is what's coming in this world. I mean, the depravity that is hiding beneath the sophisticated veneers of this world is absolutely ready for a free fall into the worst type of depravity possible. And that's just one aspect. The combativeness, too, is also here. Those who love, viciousness in combat. You've seen that with ISIS. You see it in Mexico, of the cults of the dead virgin cults there. You go down into Central America. I mean, I talked to a lady from Central America. And she told me exactly what's happening. This wonderful, down-to-earth, God-fearing, Holy Spirit, grace-knowing woman. I had a talk with her like 3 in the morning in the hospital, and she's from El Salvador, and she told me exactly what is happening in El Salvador. And, you know, you could hardly believe what she was telling me. It is so terrible. The depravity, the drugs, all of this, and the shooting, the murdering, what's going on from the young people there, is you just can't believe it. She says it's just abhorrent, so terrible, you can't even hardly explain. She was just devastated by it. It's sport. They'll kill you for sport. That's sport. They'll go hunting, and they go hunting for people and just kill them in cold blood, and there's no police, no policing of the situation whatsoever. The police are terrified of them. These young people with guns have just lost all sense of civility, civilization altogether. He says the whole country is terrorized by them. The whole country is this way now. The entire country. Let me just look at this for one moment. Why would someone be texting me this? Okay. All right, very good. So, this account of what's happening in El Salvador was a heads up to me of what's coming for the world. And this is Central America, South America, I mean, Venezuela is collapsing. I mean, this is what's coming. And then the guy telling me about Mount St. Helens, he said civilization collapsed. These are Americans are talking about. Supposedly, we're also civilized. He said, no. Everyone went crazy, collapsed, and became vicious. He said, especially the women. And then he said, it just shocked the heck out of them. And this lady said, thank God for El Salvador. Thank God for America. Thank God for this area. She says, my God, I thank God every day that there's civilization here, she said. You don't know, she says. When you lose law and order, you don't know what happens. But she says, I know. And I said, look, I believe you. I absolutely understand what you're saying. And this attack against law and order in the United States of America is a precursor to try to pull the world down into the savagery, which will then cause people to be desperate for what? For a global dictatorship. Exactly what it's designed for. When you get plunged into despair and depression and all this, you then are willing to enslave yourself, mentally enslave yourself to a dictatorship, which is exactly what the reptilians have planned for this planet. And they're using the politicians, etc., who are trying to undermine law and order for exactly that purpose. They say, we'll make you president, but this is what you got to do. And they say, well, yeah, I really want to be president. That'd be a lot of fun, you know, egomaniac. Yeah, the reptilians have that power now in this world to make and break the leaders of the countries of the world and institutions of the world. They absolutely do have that power. So, this is a heads up. I haven't gotten so many strong heads up. The media is not telling the truth so much. I mean, of course, the rampage that ISIS is on is just horrific, of course. They just live to butcher, okay? They just live to butcher. And they're justifying it, of course, through you know, say it's a jihad, which, you know, it's you know, there's different ways to call it a jihad, you know? I mean, they're using it as an excuse. Okay, I understand the jihad against Western culture, what they're getting at of materialism, but that they're just using that as an excuse. You can do a spiritual jihad through prayer, okay, through grace of God, and living, becoming saints. Well, you know, they're not doing that. They're using it as an excuse for mayhem. Kind of like the Crusaders have used the excuse of Christianity for mayhem too. People use excuses for mayhem, right? Try to use a positivity excuse. Oh, no, we're positive. This is positivity, what we're doing. No. Positivity is the ugly face of arrogance, actually. What religion calls us to is not positivity, but super positivity. And super positivity does not engage in attack and mayhem or any of that. Jesus says attack is never justified. Okay, this is the voice of super positivity, Jesus Christ. He says attack is never justified. Never. Okay, that ends that discussion right there, plain and simple. Attack is never justified. And he said, if I defend myself, I'm attacked. Because I'm trying to attack my own freedom and saying that something can happen to me. Nothing can happen to me. You know, it's very advanced. I understand this. But you can start somewhere and say attack is never justified. It's a question of getting used to this belief system of super positivity. You have to get used to it. Okay, it flips the script of the world upside down. And he says the world is upside down and backwards with its belief system entirely. Egoic belief system is upside down and backwards. Now, of course it's very difficult to get used to this, but I have faith that what he's saying is absolutely true without any exception whatsoever. Is it difficult to apply it in all circumstances? Of course it is. Of course it is. But he understands that. He says it's enough that you keep practicing this and go in this direction. Okay? This is what I'm calling you towards. To go in this direction. And you must have faith to go in this direction, of course. Because the ego is very clever at trying to pull up exceptions and say, what do you mean? You know, that there's only 360-degree innocent. We're all perfectly innocent. He says, what are you talking about? What about Hitler? You know, the ego tries to bring up these, you know, things. Excuses? No. I had no exception to this whatsoever. There is no exception to this. We're all completely innocent. There's only total innocence. Reality is total innocence. And there's only total innocence, which means there's only reality. That's all there's ever been or ever will be. Total innocence. 360-degree total innocence. That's all there is. No exception whatsoever. So we have tried to change reality by trying to pretend all these exceptions. And keep in mind, everything is just pretense. So we say, well, what about Hitler? Well, what about Hitler? Everything that happens here, death is only pretending. 100% pretense. Suffering is only pretending. So there was a lot of pretending going on. Just like there's a lot of pretending going on right now. There always is. There always is. This is a dream of death. And death is mere pretense. It's mere pretense. So, yeah, Hitler, 100% innocence. Every person that's ever been here, 100% innocence. Every spirit, 100% innocence. No exceptions to whatsoever. A lot of pretending to try to make it seem otherwise. All to no avail. All to no avail. Just as Jesus says, just aimless wandering. Arrogance is just the aimless wandering of arrogance. Complete futility. We cannot be other than perfectly innocent. It's impossible. It's impossible. It's completely impossible. I don't care if you have a million Hitlers. It's completely impossible still. Okay? There's just perfect, total, 360-degree innocence. That's all there is. We can never lose that. We can never go astray from that. It's impossible. No matter what we do. So you have to have, you know, we have to have faith in this, because our habits are so bad, and our, you know, that our doubts arise, sure, but we just turn away from those doubts. Say, I know that's false. I know it's false, but it's just a habit. It's continuity fear, as I say. It's just continuity fear. It's a dance of continuity fear. So I say, okay, that's just my continuity fear barking at me, but I'm not. I know it's just barking at me, but I'm not going to be intimidated by it. I'm going to keep practicing super positivity. I will not be let my continuity fear. I'll stop in the wow, yeah. Full stop in the wow. When it gets too strong, okay. But I'm not going to be intimidated by it. I'll accept a certain degree of intimidation, full stop in the wow, neither advancing or retreating. And then let it wear off, let it wear off, and then I'm gonna keep advancing then once I get used to this wow. I'm going to keep advancing. So in that staircase I was climbing, I reached this point where it got foggy. I couldn't see anything. And I said, wow, I know there's a staircase there because I glimpsed it. And I know the fog is just obscuring it. Should I conclude that the stairs suddenly have disappeared and they're not there? I said, no, that's crazy. That's insane. I know the stairs are still there, so I'm going to keep advancing. So I kept advancing up the stairs, even though they were obscured by this heavy fog. And that's when I reached the top. And that's when the light was there, and these helpers were there. And they made sure I was given this approval of a wristband showing that I had reached the top successfully. And that's when the lady in red appeared, Vajrayogini, because I had use the right skillful means of meditation, this full stop in the wow practice, you call it practice, you don't have to call it meditation, it's practice, that even though doubt, the barking of doubt, of continuity fear is there, I still said, no, this is just continuity fear, let me just go a little, slow down a little bit, if I get too afraid, I'll just stop for a while and let the fear dissipate, and then my reason comes back, I say, no, the steps are there, just keep going, and this is what works. So this full stop in the wow is what works. This is the high spiritual practice. She came to Naropa, I think. I think Talopa is the one that brought this full stop in the wow practice. I think he was involved with Naropa too or something. This lineage of this full stop in the wow practice actually brings you to Vajrayogini, brings you to the highest kind of help. It's the super practice, actually, that we've been doing all along here. Thanks to the Holy Spirit. I didn't know anything about Talopa or Naropa, really. Didn't know about this practice or anything. The Holy Spirit brought it to me step by step by step. Gradually recognize this is the way to go. Because we take these steps, the continuity fear fogs our mind with doubt. And then we just say, oh, okay, wow, I just reached a wow. I'm just going to let this wait here. Don't take another step at all. And just be patient, let it dissipate. And then later, once it dissipates, you find out you have great more confidence and clarity. And so now you can see the next step. You say, oh, I can see the next step, and then you take another and another, and then the fog comes back, and then you kind of stop and wait for the fog to kind of lift a little bit. But even if it doesn't lift entirely, you have the confidence. You know, okay, it's just continuity fear. It's just a wow, and I can and you can keep pushing it pretty well. You keep pushing it and get to the top of the staircase. Now, I owe black people, African Americans, I owe them a debt. So I'm very indulgent, understanding with them, and it helps me out because you know they're being used to in a very bad way by this whole scenario. Actually, they really are. They have a different mindset, kind of. It's interesting, but they've been hit hard with drugs, hard with poverty. All this stuff can drive them into despair, and it's a complicated situation. But the bottom line is that my dad was saved by African Americans. He passed out in a path in the middle of the Congo. He was walking across the equator through the Congo, through Africa at the equator. He was an adventurer, an explorer, my dad. And he caught malaria, and there was no treatment for it. And him and his buddy, just two of them, his buddy didn't have malaria, and so they decided that to split up, the buddy would go look for help. Well, what happened was the buddy just actually abandoned him. He found out later when he reached the east coast of Africa, he saw his buddy there, and it turns out his buddy just abandoned him. So my dad passed out from a fever and malaria on some, you know, trail through the dark jungle of the Congo in Africa, and was left there to die. And he was unconscious and delirious and didn't know what ultimately what happened. He woke up in a mission hospital, a Christian mission, which I also have a debt of gratitude towards Christian missionaries, because he woke up and was treated at a Christian mission in the heart of the Congo. This woman there, Christian woman, nursed him back to health. But they had quinine, the missionary mission there. And what happened was these African Americans, these tribesmen, were going along this path, and they saw him there, passed out unconscious. They picked him up and carried him. God knows how far they carried him. I think it was a long distance on their backs. And brought him to this mission. The African Americans have a deep spirituality in them. They're kind of freaked out by the modern world. They don't relate to it well. God knows, we all are kind of freaked out by it, aren't we? African Americans have a very good side to them. And they're caught in being used as like pawns. They're being caught up in this caught up in a bad situation here. Anyway, I have a debt of gratitude, you know, towards them saving my dad. I wouldn't be here if they hadn't saved my dad's life like that. And so I have reasons to feel gratitude towards all sorts of people, because if you look for it, you can find reason to find gratitude towards everybody, really, in some way, if you look at it. But so I saw this African American today, and I've seen him before, and he's begging for money, and he looks like he's in pretty healthy shape and everything. He does. He's kind of dapper looking and everything. And I'm not sure if I saw him the day previously there with his girlfriend or his wife, whatever. They were just sitting there, and they weren't even making the attempt to get money. But this time he had a sign, and he can't read the sign or anything. And I said, I don't care, you know, what he's up to. You know, hey, let me give him a hallelujah here. So again, I threw a dollar bill out the window. I saw him, and I know what to do now. And I say, well, okay, he doesn't even walk down for the cars. He's just, I don't know. I mean, how are you going to get money if you just stand on the corner? The light turns red. There's just one car there, and the rest of them, you know, you can't get money from them. You got to walk back in the line of cars. Well, he's not even doing that, really. And then the light turns green, they're all passing you by. They can't stop to give you money. And who knows why it's there? You know, it's not, it doesn't matter. So I threw the money out the window, and he said, oh, he said, thanks, man, thank you so much. And, you know, and he's got this positive vibe. And I saw another black man, the African-American, the day before, coming in this junk truck to pick up some junk, a water heater or something. And he was kind of like, you know, he's this older guy. But he gave this a really good vibe and a great laugh. And he says, hey, can I get some help? Because I said, hey. So the young guys picked up this real heavy appliance. And I said, hey, what's the matter? You can't do it? And he goes, hey, man, I used to do it, you know. And I said, yeah, used to. I said, I did too. We all used to be able to do it. And he gave this huge laugh. And it was like, yeah, you know, like, guess what? We're getting older, you know. We all used to be able to do it, right? And so he had a real beautiful vibe to him. The African Americans have a lot of beautiful soul if it comes out right, you know, but it can also not come out right, because what? Why? It's positivity. Okay, they're not hooked into super positivity. Not very well. Not very well. Okay? This is a deficiency. It's a deficiency of everyone. But the problem in America was that we Americans went looking for positivity, and where they go looking for it in the 60s and 70s, especially in the African Americans, because African Americans still had soul, they called it, is unaffected positivity. And they thought this was the answer. White America thought black America had the answer for them. And so they went just nuts for soul, for the soul of African Americans, because African Americans were much more freer in their positivity. And we thought that's what we need. White Americans so uptight, they're corporate robots, you know. We're in the military-industrial complex, and you know, white bread in the suburbs. We were like, it's like, I'm going crazy. And then, you know, here's Curtis Mayfield, you know, here's Diana Ross and the Supremes, and here's all these black musicians, and just, I mean, they're just like grooving and moving, and they're not hung up on white bread culture, you know. They got a real sliced stone, and I mean, it goes on and on and on and on. So all these uptight white people are saying, "Oh my God, you know, they're moving, they're grooving, and they're, you know, Ray Charles and it just goes, you know, Stevie Wonder, and it just goes Otis Redding, you know, rhythm and soul, or the blues. Are you kidding me? B.B. King and Albert King and all the kings, and you know, all and then all the old bluesmen too, right? And so we just flipped out over that, the black soul, and black soul was the thing. It was the hip thing. What is that? That's positivity. So what happened was, the blacks say, what in the world's going on? Why does everybody think we're so great? But you know, they're kind of like, I mean, kind of freaked them out, actually. Because like, we're looking to them for our salvation all of a sudden. And they say, they're kind of like, you know, I don't got your salvation for you. What are you crazy white people talking about? But I'm glad that you're, you know, brother in me, you know, and everything, and you really accept. But see, they didn't really understand what the heck was going on. They still don't. Nobody really does. I do, but not many understand what really happened. Is the white people went crazy. Said, we can't find it. Our positivity just isn't working for us. This materialism is killing us. And we need better positivity. And so they saw the blacks as the African Americans and third world people as their saviors. So they went to India. They went to third worlding. Okay, they were looking for salvation. They were looking for, you know, you're keeping it real, man, sister, you know, I mean, it's just like, you know, down with the grooving. We really got, let's really groove here. They also went for drugs, they went for sex and all this stuff, but the soul power thing was a big, big deal. We all got caught up in that soul power thing. But the blacks, they're just African Americans, whatever you want to call it, the brothers and the sisters, they're saying like, what's wrong with these crazy white guy people? They're thinking we're their saviors. We're not their saviors. But they kind of got a complex out of all of that. And then, of course, the subversion of drugs came in. And you know, really decimated black culture is the drugs, the cocaine that came in, which was intentionally done, actually. two, develop lawlessness, develop a severe lawlessness among African Americans, because they have a different way of handling anger. They can flip into anger pretty quickly. It's a different style. Okay, you know, and so drugs were brought in and decimated black culture, and black culture really got freaked out by the whole thing of what happened, of everybody counting on them for answers. Okay, and now you got this, what, just, you know, it's terrible. You see the older African Americans, I mean, they're still cool, you know. You see them, you run into some African Americans that aren't caught up into drugs and all this kind of stuff, and you know, they're really cool people, to say the least. But that's, unfortunately, that kind of culture is you know, disappearing, and you've got the rap culture and the thug culture and the gangster culture, and it's nasty stuff. It's really terrible stuff. And you've got all that being now told that that's the new positivity, you know, and law and order is the negativity. This is the terrible thing. Let's just turn it over to the gangsters, you know, and like they're saying, what the heck has happened to our, and you get, of course, white people say, what has happened to my culture? What has happened to our America? It's been turned inside, upside down. Well, guess what? Meet Mr. and Mrs. Reptilian, who have engineered this whole thing. The extraterrestrials have engineered this. I mean, we blame the Illuminati, but behind them are the extraterrestrials, actually. And they're doing this, so we'll turn to them for our salvation. And they say, oh, the reptilians say, oh, well, we have super positivity. We got all the right drugs that you need. And we'll turn you all into sex goddesses and, you know, the hedonism. We'll have this perfect hedonism paradise here because we know how to, you know, genetically engineer and blah, 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 blah. And then people then will just fall into that like crazy. But they're using the black culture, the rank gangster culture, rap culture, Salvadoran problem, you know, all this stuff is going on in the world, ISIS, etc., to scare the living Jesus out of us, you know. So... we'll like jump into their hedonistic paradise here and become mind slaves of the reptilians. That's why the Vajrayogini is here. She's going to knock some reptilian heads, you know, to put it in a spiritual context, not literally, but she knows how to deal with these swashbucklers. These pus-filled, rotting flesh bags. Yeah, she knows how to deal with that hedonistic nonsense. Hedonistic. This really, it's really the ugly face of arrogance is what's being marketed to us. There's nothing worse than putting a positive spin on arrogance. That's the worst. That's the worst. So yeah, I threw the bunny out the window, and he got it. He understood. He's not too proud to pick it up, and I understood. I say, you know, here's a guy that maybe his great grandfather was one of the guy that picked my dad up unconscious in the middle of the Congo, and carried him for, you know, 100 miles or something. You know, I don't know how far, but yeah, right, keeping him alive, hydrating him somehow. Giving him water or something, you know, right? Maybe it was his great-grandfather who did that. And I'm also saying to him, hey, you know, we're not at war with you, okay? White America is not at war with black America. No way. We've got a common enemy, and that's the reptilians, actually, and this New World Order bureaucratic octopus of the reptilians, extraterrestrials, cosmic corporate culture. That's just the tentacles. New World Order is just the tentacles of this monstrous octopus whose beak is going to eat you alive, right? Think about, keep that mental image. So Vajrayogini does use these mental images that are shocking. You say, whoa, I don't want that mental image. Yeah. It's a shock treatment for sure, but we can embrace it. If you're following it far enough along on the path, you can embrace it and say, thank you, thank you, thank you. That's very helpful. You know, the commercial, the aftershave, you just slap, like, ah, thanks, I needed that, you know. The sting of the aftershave, ah, thanks, I really needed that. You know, it tightens up the pores, doesn't it? Got to tighten up the pores here. So again, both black culture and white culture, we need to stop the animosity and realize we're being used or being played, or being both being played. And we don't get agitated with one another. We go into super positivity. And there's some great, wonderful African American heritage people in the world, like for instance, Muji, for instance. Okay, there's someone, the Church of Now has a little channel here, I guess in Jamaica. There's a lot of beautiful Jamaicans that you know, some of them are maybe into super positivity. Muji, I believe, is into super positivity, at least to some extent. I don't know to how much he is. I encourage him to keep doing it. Make it even more so. Make it even more so, and get the help from Vajrayogini, because he does have a large following of yoga girls, or at least potential yoga girls. You better look out. Better look out about that. Just encourage him, because he's been helpful. He does talk the talk of super positivity, you know, to a significant extent, I would say. So there are some very wise African American heritage people, and they need to step up with super positivity to help out, okay? Because there are some very nasty ones. We have a president of the United States right now who's a very nasty exploiter, demagogue exploiter of the black community. And we've had other ones come along before him. You know their names, these carpet-bagging exploiters of the black community. They're terrible. They're absolutely terrible. And they're trying to fester, you know, animosity between the African American community and the white community of America, and they're trying to create this war between the two of them. These are very, very vicious folks, and we love them, but we got to tell them that we're going to sick Vajrayogini on you, okay? And so you better get ready for that. What they're doing is very arrogant, very ugly, very arrogant. We are not enemies. We are not enemies. The common enemy of all is our own arrogance, okay? We all have a common enemy, and it's our own arrogance. And we're not looking to one another for positivity, okay? So let us forgive one another, and understand, white America has to understand that we kind of freaked out black America by looking for them for our salvation. We got to back off of that, you know, and understand that positivity is not it. I don't care if you're boogalooing, you know, or watusing, or doing all these frugging, or doing all these dances, or, you know, getting down. That's not it. That's not it. And we demanded too much of that, and that they couldn't deliver it, you know, and so they turned to drugs to try to be even more hip. You know, now we got hip hop, right? They feel they got to be so hip. Guess what? You don't have to be hip for me anymore. You don't have to be hip for me. I've got the hipness of super positivity, and that's coming from the Dharma Kings. Okay, it's not coming from any race or body, or, you know, it's not coming. It's coming straight from the Holy Spirit. My super hipness is coming straight from this Holy Spirit. So I'm taking all of you off the hook. All you African Americans, I'm taking you off the hook. Absolutely, you're off the hook. You know, and there's no animosity between us at all. Okay, we have a common foe, and that's our own spiritual pride and the continuity fear. And you could say the reptilian, cosmic corporate culture, the reptilians are who, you know, that's a common foe of all of us, actually. But even that, we can heal that divide too, because they all are common foe of all of us is our own arrogance, actually. But in the near short-term thing, you know, I'm talking this talk of super hipness now, and so back away from the hip hopness and the gangster stuff and all that kind of rap stuff, all that kind of stuff. Okay, they're looking, they're trying to find, oh, finally the whites loved us so much, but you know what? It wasn't really love, was it? It really wasn't love. It was never love. It was desperation. It was looking for positivity, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. It wasn't really love. And this is what's kind of weirded out the black community, is, you know, they need to realize, no, it wasn't really love. It really wasn't. And so you tried to be so hip, you know, you tried to be uber hip, and you've gone down some roads that you wouldn't have gone down otherwise, and you need to back away from all that stuff. You need to back away from it and go to super positivity. Quiet contemplation, full stop in the wow, just wow it all. Otherwise, you know what's coming. Let's be very clear about that. There's a lot of people who are really pissed off, okay, in this world right now. And you don't want to let them exploit you so just they can use it as an excuse to act out how upset they are. You see what I'm saying? Yeah, African Americans were very talented musically, brought a lot of soul and stuff, but keep in mind, music is just positivity. Music is never super positivity, actually. It's never super positivity. Even the Beach Boys are not super positivity, and nobody had the sound that the Beach Boys had, not before and not since. They had the reverb chamber, of course, of Gold Star Studio, and Western too. One of Gold Star maybe even was a little better. That's what Phil Spector used for the Wall of Sound. And he said that, he actually said that it was notoriously fickle and tough to dial in, and you could lose it quickly. But when you dial that echo chamber, reverb chamber, echo chamber in at Gold Star Studios, there's nothing better. I mean, produced a sound that we've never heard before, and the Beach Boys with their insanely great harmonies. I mean, it's just never been before or after. It was just unbelievable. It almost bordered on unbelievability, but there was a lot of technical stuff that was enabled it, actually. Gold Star Studio was David Gold and Stan Ross. The Gold Star came from Gold, David Gold, his last name, and then Star came from the S from Stan and Ross. No, Star, what was his name? Stan, what was his name? Stanley. I forgot his last name again, but it was the S and then A. STAR, something like that. Gold Star Studio. It's a trivial detail, but they built this reverb chamber that was just when you got it right, it just mind blowing. Of course, Motown had their reverb chamber too, which was good. It was consistent, very consistent. You got to realize that these singers, they sounded so good, the music sounded so good because of the slapback and the reverb chamber and the magnetic tape and the vacuum tube consoles and the Neumann 47 microphones and all the stuff that were in use and the engineering, etc. That just put the gold on, what do they call it, the gloss on it, you know. They could put the gloss on it, the sparkle on it. To an extreme extent. And when you hear them just dry, these musicians just dry, it's like, what happened? What? You know. You hear the Beach Boys live, like you hear them play live, it's just like, what? I mean, they're still, you can hear the talent there, but it doesn't sound anything like the record. So, that, you know, they the positivity they got back in that time was probably the most strongest positivity we've ever had in the world. There's been other times and places when the grand courts of like the French Louis the 14th or 15th, one of those. I mean, there's been times with Peter in Russia, the great courts, aristocratic courts with all the lovely ladies and the dresses and the finery and the you know, the gilded palaces and the food and everything. I mean, you've had extreme examples of positivity in classical music. You get, you know, Mozart playing and Bach and Haydn and Mendelssohn and, you know, Chopin, Mozart. I might have said his name before. The courtly music, you had some super positivity going on with that. Back in the King Solomon's time, of course, the Roman time, Egyptian, the times of Pharaoh. Throughout history, there's been building up a positivity, and then the collapse into chaos. Okay, this is what it's all a setup for. It's a setup. Positivity is a setup. Look at Brian Wilson. What happened to him? Did you know he collapsed when he was age 22? Tried to get on an airplane, had a panic attack, and quit the band. He couldn't travel anymore. In fact, it devastated his psyche. This panic attack devastated his psyche. He became a recluse and lay in bed ultimately, and ended up laying in bed for 3 years. Never got out of bed for 3 years. Had to go to the bathroom. They served him in bed his food mostly. I mean, he just completely withdrew from the world because it wasn't enough. The positivity he had wasn't enough, and so he started taking LSD and the drugs just like crazy. He used so many drugs, it's just LSD so much, it's just unbelievable. Why? He was trying to find the super positivity in, through music. And you can't get the super top positivity through music. It's impossible. You can get it through sound, but it's the sound of the spheres. I've actually heard it. That's super positivity. Everything emitting a tone, just this total toneness of everything, all in harmony. That's super positivity. You can't get that through an orchestra. No way we can do that. It's all just positivity. So Brian Wilson quit the band, and then Bruce Johnston joined it, taking his part. And then Carl Wilson covered the high parts, which Carl was a great singer, but not. It wasn't Brian Wilson. Brian Wilson sang the lead in Don't Worry Baby. You listen to that lead, that song, listen to it carefully on stereo, a stereo mix, and Brian Wilson singing is just extraordinarily great. He's an extraordinarily great singer, along with producer, writer, composer, everything. He's a complete musical genius, but he collapsed at the age of 22. That's pretty much, he collapsed in 19... Probably I think around 1966 was it, or 65? It was 65, 66, somewhere around in there. I was, you know, it's funny. I collapsed when I was about 22. So into severe depression. He became very introspective, and then did, of course, the Pet Sounds album, which was really just about him and his introspective and all the troubles he was having and stuff. And I liked the earlier Beach Boys better than Pet Sounds stuff, actually, when it was just vibrant. Don't Worry Baby. Confident, super confident. They had super confidence that they knew that they were the boss. Absolutely knew it. They had photographic memories, all of them, for arrangements and song parts and vocal parts. They remembered everything. Al Jardine said they had photographic memories, all of them. It was just amazing. And they just kicked it and come, and you can hear it, just the confidence, and just it wasn't like they were straining to do what they were doing. Nobody had ever heard anything like this before. No, they were just knocking it out and said, we can do this anytime we want to, and we can do better than this. You ain't heard nothing yet of what we can do. They had that sort of positivity, confidence, radical positivity, confidence. And yet what happens? Brian Wilson can't get onto an airplane, and suddenly the whole thing starts falling apart, and it's not never the same after that, really. I mean, the greatness was still there, but the confidence wasn't there anymore. And man, that I started going downhill at a young age. When the Beach Boys started going downhill, I had hooked my star to the Beach Boys, thinking that this in California culture, SoCal culture, this positivity is going to, you know, cure what ails us. And when it fell apart, you know, I went down the tubes. I didn't have anything else to go lean, you know, to fall back on, really. It was, for me, every day was summer. This is the Beach Boys, the endless summer, you know. Summer days and summer nights. It was all this California culture was the ultimate positive that the world's ever seen, in my opinion, because we had the weather, too. And you had the California girls out here, of course, who came from all over the world, who were, you know, were into outdoor recreation and the diet out here. The world had never seen so many beautiful women or beautiful girls ever. All their teeth were, you know, orthodontics were in, so all their teeth were perfect. And you know, beauty salons, and everyone had access to all the beauty salons and beauty secrets. And the suntans, you know, tanning year round here, you know, it was ridiculous. The Corvettes, the convertible Corvettes, and you go on and on and on and on and on. It's just like everybody wanted to be a California girl and a California guy, and you know, it was just youth culture was in full bloom, and people are so healthy and educated, and it's just, you know, these are all the daughters and sons of engineers and these after the World War II of the military industrial complex, the you know, Lockheeds and IBMs and on and on and on, and FMCs, and you just name it. There's so many. They all took root in Southern California and the Bay Area, but mostly Southern California more than anything. And these people were smart, smartest people, super smart, super well educated, very creative, very talented, and very wealthy. And there was their sons and daughters that were all these California girls and guys and buying the Corvettes and stuff. It's just going to the drive-ins and having burgers and shakes and going to, you know, just living the life in Pasadena, you name it. And, you know, this was just positivity that the world had never seen before, and the confidence that came out of Southern California, and to some extent the Bay Area, but more Southern California, from all these wealthy, healthy young people, was just amazing. And then you had, of course, this something in back in New York, where New Yorkers were way more artistic, and they had their own artistic confidence coming out of New York, or the Woodstock people. So that was another part of the whole thing. But it was even more positive out here in California, because we think we'd found Nirvana, actually. Where the New Yorkers thought that maybe they found some sort of academic momentum that was going to lead to some sort of high art. Where the Beach Boys said, high art, you don't need high art, man. Let's just go to the beach. And that's all you need. I mean, it's just 365 days out of the year here. You just go to the beach and you can't miss it. Just everybody's chasing girls, and girls, of course, love being chased, and it was all just, you know, everybody had these beautiful houses, beautiful landscaping, healthy food. It was just crazy. And then when I started falling apart and the problems started coming up and all this stuff, you know, you just, when California culture collapsed, I didn't have anything else, really, except I did, which was Saints. My great belief and faith in saints. And that's what ultimately saved me. I just had this unshakable belief in the greatness of saints and gurus. And I believe the answer was in the mind. But still, I fell, you know, fell prey to the collapse of California culture, the belief that it was simply was the answer. We believed in it out here. There's been a lot of buildup to that. You know, Los Angeles was actually engineered by people back east, New Yorkers, powerful bankers, you name it, from Pennsylvania, New York, New Jersey, Connecticut, and that, who tried to build a paradise, a utopia out here. And the whole thing was structured for that purpose. And they were, you know, their sons and daughters came, they moved out to California, and then they brought this tremendous confidence in themselves. Yeah, so it was, and people still talk it to this day. If you live through it, you know that was maybe could be the most strongest positivity this world's ever had. The most compelling. Anyway, all the sick people came out to California. They was told that you come out here, you're going to get well. The gold is in the plants, in the soil, in the vegetables, the fruits. I mean, just the fruits they had out here, and the vegetables, and the healthiness of the animals. Everything was just off the charts, never seen before. And in the dry air and the wonderful atmosphere, sick people came out here to get well, and it was the gold rush, a spiritual gold rush of people thinking that they were going to come out here and they were going to find nirvana, paradise on earth. And this was what it was all about, California. It was paradise on earth, and it was powerful, powerful, powerful. And just the weather itself makes you feel that you are in paradise. And so this built up until you got the whole California Girl thing. And, you know, the song California Girls by the Beach Boys is, you know, just swept the planet, really. And the advertising, you know, the Los Angeles advertising, it was just using all these super healthy, beautiful people. It just seeped into everybody's psyche, you know. California Dreamin' by the Mamas and the Papas, right? That was it. You came out here to get healthy, to get well, to get sane, to find it. And then everybody's into the Esalen and counter groups and Gestalt and this, and I, you know, we're here, we're finding it. And it's just, you know, the goddess culture. I made so many of these women like into this goddess complex, came out of here. That in New York too. You always have, you have the Jewish American princess complex that's been, you know, going on for a long time. You had that in New York, and the Japs thing, and very confident people, confident women, goddess, you know, cultural goddesses back in New York area, the East Coast, and in London too. You had that, the Beatles, they had the super confidence about their, you know, British culture and all that. So it's all these various places of confidence, in positivity. And of course, it never works. It always collapses. And then you turn to sex, drugs, and rock and roll, and there are these varmints down there who know how to exploit you. They're just waiting for you, like spiders waiting for you to fall into hell. And this is what the Christian symbology is all about. It's talking about positivity doesn't work, and you know, the hell is right beneath you, this hideous roasting hell, and you know, you're ready to drop into this hell. Well, this is really very accurate, actually. It's very accurate. This is really the situation where we're right now. You know, what was it, Jonathan Edwards, the great evangelist, who scared the heck out of people? The fear of God put the fear of God into people. And that's the gift that I got in Catholic Church last Sunday. We all got these fortune cookies of paper, and I opened it up. It says, my gift of the Holy Spirit was the fear of God. And maybe I can put the fear of God in people. And maybe I am doing that, because I'm telling you, this is what we're, Jonathan Edwards used to say, like we're like a spider that's hanging over this cauldron of a fiery cauldron, and the heat is melting the thread that we're on, you know. And every moment we're just, any moment we could drop into this hellish inferno. So you better be safe right now, brothers and sisters. And maybe I'm going to go around doing it with Jonathan Edwards. I don't know. The great revivals, of course, you know, the Welsh revival, the various revivals in Protestantism, you know, brought the fear of God into the situation and scared people straight back into the grace of God. And we need that right now. We need to be scared straight into the back into the grace of God, because we are over a burning cauldron, the likes of which the world has never seen. The fiery torments of hell are waiting for us to drop down in there with, and they got their pitchforks ready. You got these deviants that are with pitchforks ready just to absolutely poke you like you've never been poked before, and stab you and bring you down in the worst way possible when positivity collapses. And I've, you know, been through that already, when the collapse of the California Dream collapsed, and it was just hell, absolute hell out here. I'm a survivor. You can't really say you survived hell. It's not really surviving. I didn't survive, but right now I am ready to thrive in a way that can never be touched by that hell. Okay, and this is what we need. We need the super positivity. We need the super positivity. Working on my voice, singing. Last, I started, I think I pretty much started when I saw that video by, what's his name? Soland, or, what's his name again? Bradford Soland. Bradford Soland. The Tucson birder's daughter, or something like that. I a couple of songs I heard from him. Over the Rainbow and Don't Worry, Be Happy. And I was so inspired by his style and his heart. You know, here's someone that loves Jesus for sure. I was so inspired by his love of Jesus that I said, I'm going to start singing again. And so I started singing. I hadn't sung in a long time. Yeah, I sing a little bit in church every week, but I've kind of given that up. And wow. I still had it, but I didn't have any endurance at all. And my voice, then after just practicing, my voice just became real flat and terrible. Well, I sort of stopped for a couple of days. Today, I started again, and it came back really strong, really strong. And I was more careful this time. I didn't strain it. Drinking my lemonade, that helps out. And just kale smoothie helped out. I'm drinking kale smoothies now, actually, believe it or not. If you use Tuscan kale and strain it after the smoothie and strain it to get the pulp out of there, it tastes really good. I use V8, Super V8 with cherry and apple juice. What is that? Super infusion, V8 super infusion, something like that. Super fusion, V8 fusion. Use that as a base. It tastes great. Kale tastes great. I blend up about a third of a bag of Tuscan kale. Raley's Markets has that, I think. You can get this good kale. It's not as pulpy. But even then, I strain the pulp out. I try that. The pulp, it doesn't taste good. I strain the pulp out. It tastes good. And it's a powerful drink. Very powerful. I may go for another one tonight, actually. Or maybe one a day is enough. one a day. You're doing pretty good. I've been hitting the kale and singing and starting to get my power back in singing, which means I can do counterpoint with any singer. And they can't pull me along into singing exactly what they're singing. I'll sing something different that gives some spaciousness to the to their voice, what they're singing. The way to give spaciousness through counterpoint, that's what orchestration's all about. And so you have all these different orchestral parts doing different stuff, but it all blends together, but it gives a sound of spaciousness. As a composer, I was known very talented at counterpoint in my previous life. And so I've been able to sing counterpoint now to these great singers, like Brian, Beach Boys, George Jones. Those are the two of my favorites, two of the very best ever. And they can't pull me along to sing exactly what they're singing. I say, well, no, I'm going to sing my own thing. You sing your thing, I'll sing my thing, and together we'll sound even better. Also, I sing, Tammy Wynette sings with George Jones. She's one of the better female singers, and she's terrific. And I sing counterpart point with her. It's tougher. I can pull along with her. She tends to pull me along. I gotta say, well, I gotta sing differently here. Very, very amazing, great style, these singers. So, but I say, no, I'm gonna sing my style. So when I start getting my voice back, I can sing my style and make the mix better than before. Actually, I used to be able to do this. So I'm starting to get it back. I don't know how much it'll come back. Don't have the endurance yet. And so I can start out a song and sound great, and then halfway through the song, my voice has gone flat. It loses its vibrancy. And then you lose your confidence. When you lose your vibrancy, you lose your confidence. And when you lose your confidence, you lose your creativity. And then when you lose your creativity, you can't do counterpoint anymore. It doesn't sound right. You got to be really swinging it with confidence to do that. So I say, I don't know, sing. I say, sing it, George. I don't care. You sing your part, I'll sing my part. And it's that confidence. I know whatever you're saying, I can throw counterpoint to that and blend it. It'll sound great. It doesn't matter what the notes are. It sounds great. When you get to a certain level of confidence and everything, you can sing any note you want to, but you just slide it the way you slide it into other stuff. It all works. So it doesn't matter what notes you're singing. It all works, as I've said and others have said. George Jones could sing or the Beach Boys could sing the Phone Book. It would sound absolutely great. Because you never get stuck, you never lose your confidence. And so you project that confidence into the song, and that works. Confidence works. But, it's not super positivity, actually. However, there's a fine line there. It can point to it. It can point to it. It can point to it. It's pretty rare to be able to do this. And the pop singers, they don't do it. It's not there. You need someone who's super positive, playing with it. Being creatively playful with it. And it's basically saying, look, I am totally free, and even this positivity of this music, of like a Beach Boys, even that, I'm free. And I can see that it's not really it, but I can respect the creativity of it and play with it in my freedom. But I'm not hooked into it, you see. So in that way, it does resonate with some super positivity, but it's not quote unquote music like this is some sort of product. This is not music as a product, actually. It's a slippery slope. You got to be careful of music, really. You have to really be grounded in super positivity to use music at all. At music, really. Otherwise, no. Stay away from it. It's trouble. Yeah, I could just stop singing. I could stop the song. I can, you know, just go off to, you know, some super positive talk. In other words, you got to put it in the context of super positivity. If it's not grounded in the context, overall context of super positivity, it's just positivity. It's just positivity is all it is, and that is dangerous. Positivity is, again, the ugly face of arrogance. It's very dangerous. It's like a drug. It's a drug. It's how you get hooked. And they are expert users who will pull you down into their madness, okay? They really will. They really do. They really will, and they will do that. So you must work on the context of super positivity. You must develop that context at all costs. At all costs. I could start, maybe I'll start doing my Jonathan Edwards or the guy that did the Great Revival. There are a number of them who did the Great Revivals. Fire and brimstone. You know, he'd walk up and down with people would repent when he preached. He put the fear of God into them, which means that the fear of positivity. What the rug, getting the rug pulled out from under you, what's going to happen to you when you don't really turn to God's grace, when you think you've got it made with positivity and don't really repent and turn to God's grace, hell is waiting for you. The torments of hell are waiting for you, and this is true. And he actually understated how bad the torments are. The torments of severe depression leading to extreme sleeplessness, leading to completely losing all confidence and motivation, and walking around like a living dead person, that is absolutely the hellish torments that are worse than anything that you can even say. Words cannot give the impression of it. And I've lived through that to the absolute max. And, you know, if someone wanted to see what it's like, well, I certainly found out what it's like. I may have done it just to find out for sure what it was like, so I could preach against it, you know. But I'll only do that once. I'm not going to do that again. That is for sure. That's a little too adventurous. I come from a family of explorers and adventurers, actually. Our ancestors were really big-time explorers and adventurers. Admiral Byrd was one of our ancestors, North Pole guy. My dad was a big-time adventurer and explorer. Discovered the Temple of Jaguar in Tikal, Guatemala. Rediscovered it. It had been completely lost. The University of Pennsylvania discovered it in the 19th century, but he rediscovered it. It was completely grown over. Nobody even knew about it except some of the native guides. So big-time explorer and adventurer, and I have that in me. I'm a big-time explorer and adventurer, except my exploration is in the mind. Why does light suddenly go on? I don't know why. The mind. And suffering and spiritual truth. That's my exploration and adventure. So I'm very confident in this exploration, which means you get into pretty intense, difficult situations. You know, it's like my dad walking across the Congo at the equator. What the heck was he thinking? You know, that's a little too reckless, I would say. And he basically almost virtually lost his life trying to do that. But he made it. He ultimately got well from malaria and then finished it off. Walked across the equator. He didn't take a train across it or a plane. He walked across the equator, Africa. That's a pretty intense walk. So, you know, I come from that tradition. And I've kind of been walking across the equator of spiritual truth, the big equator, and I've run into some problems along the way, to say the least. So I know the problems. There's a guy in a store today. Remind me very much of one of these problematic gurus that was around, and very much so. He was a cut of the same cloth. I said, oh my gosh, this guy is so similar. Wow. It was funny because he had some crippledness in his lower body. His legs were all bowed and stuff like that. And so I was like, wow. Very, very similar. His rap, his enthusiasm, the way he was, the intensity and everything. It's just like, oh my gosh. Brought back memories. His eyes, everything. I said, holy cow, this guy's cut of the same cloth. He could be a very dangerous individual, preaching positivity with a spiritualistic spin, spiritual materialism, but not really keeping the sobriety and the seriousness and the super positivity of it, and not really bowing at the feet of the Dharma kings, which, you know, and the Vajrayogini, which we need to do. No, he said he's the one in charge of all of them. Yeah, you know, he's just an ego, spiritual egomaniac. That's dangerous territory, as many found out. Here we bow at the feet of our Dharma kings, and we absolutely love them and thank them and realize that they're the boss, not us. They're the ones who really know their stuff and their business here. And it's a dangerous business, this situation we're in. And the Holy Spirit is in charge. And there's no one higher than the Holy Spirit, okay? God put the Holy Spirit in charge of waking us from this dream. He didn't put some megalomaniacal guru in charge. And these Dharma kings have earned their stripes and proven themselves to us, okay, that they're emanations of the Holy Spirit. And I've met them, and I know they're quiet and sober and serious and blessed and humble. And they look at you and you as a friend, as an equal. They just are waking you up to the fact that you're equal to them. That's their only purpose. They're not saying that they're greater than you and will be forever greater than you, and you can never be as great as them. And they, you know, oh, this is spiritual ego trip. No. They say, look, you are absolutely equal to me. We're all equal to one another, and you just don't know it because you've been on this arrogant trip. But I will wake you up to your equality to me, which is perfection. So I was really stunned by this guy. Oh my, who's that remind me of? Oh my gosh. This guy was very vocally, body languagely confident, but then suddenly I saw him walking, and he was all, had this very bizarre walk and crippled walk and everything. I said, oh my gosh, this guy has got something wrong with him for sure. It's kind of like, let's make positivity, this is the ultimate in positivity, without being actually super positive. That's what his shtick was. And a number of them were like that. Let's play the game of positivity. I'll be like the ultimate positivity, that you can never be quite as much. But, you know, but the problem is, this never reached real super positivity. It was just, let's do the ultimate in positivity. So they played this game, oh, you're the ultimate guru of positivity. Yeah, well, so what? It's not super positivity. And when that rug got pulled out from everybody, you know, people had severe troubles with this guru and with others. Severe, severe troubles. Nasty stuff. Now, I've had some frustrations with Dharma kings and Sri Sri Nandamayi Ma, because she'd used tough love and various things that really worked. You know, she had to take emergency measures in my case and in everyone's case. And so she, you know, she put me through some very strong, very, very dedicated efforts and tough love and all that kind of stuff. But, you know, I have tremendous gratitude for that. Saved me from the fire. This is how Vajra Yogini works. She brings the shock treatment in the right way. In the right way. Leads me to other teachers. Says, look, you need to go listen to them because they're going to give you skillful means. So puts herself last. Puts herself at the lowest. This is the real top-notch guru. They put themselves, like Jesus, puts everyone first. Washes the feet of everybody else. The lowest of the low, the servant of all. That's the top dog. Okay, those are the top dogs. That you feel the humility, the equality, the friendship, you know, all of that, you feel it. When you look at them, you don't see any spiritual ego trip. You feel the love of God there. And he says, you're going to wake up and you're going to be just like me. And we're all absolutely equal, all included in the perfect freedom that is reality. And the space-like nature of mind is just one mind, and we are all that mind. All our four dharma kings. Exactly like that. You meet Rama Maharshi, and you'll say he's the most kindest, benevolent being you've ever met. And that he placed you on an absolutely equal level with himself, without any question about it. Then no spiritual ego in any of them, no spiritual ego whatsoever, none. So I still have, you know, more work to do. I got to look into some stuff that some of these charlatans who are on this positivity ego trip of positivity being the ultimate in positivity, they can talk about these, you know, spirituality like they're know-it-alls and be kind of pretty convincing, actually, if they've read enough esoteric stuff and they dig into it so they can put on a good act. So that can still trip you up pretty good, you know. But if you know your stuff a little bit, you can just say, if they try to, you know, they'll try to drop names on you, but if you've really met these teachers, it doesn't work, you know, because you're friends with these teachers, you know, you're friends with them. I say these teachers are my friends, and they will continue to be my friends. They got my back. Somebody had my back today. I was trying to pick up this really heavy object that was really cumbersome, and I couldn't do it. I don't, it was really bizarre. I could not lift it off the ground. I was struggling, and suddenly someone swooped in and said, no, leave it alone. I got it. I got your back. Don't worry. Let me deal with it. There's four of them. Four things, heavy things I had to lift all the same, and I couldn't do it. I said, wow, it was embarrassing. I thought I was in good shape. I've been working out, and this really strong guy showed up. And he said, don't worry, man, I got your back. And he lifted them all in, just boom. It's two guys, another guy, he brought another guy with him. Another friend of mine, a couple friends, really, really good guys. And he just told me, he says, look, I've got your back, don't worry about it. I just kind of apologized to him. He said, don't worry about it, man, don't worry about it. I'm not going to let you break your back on this. I'm stronger, I got your back. And he was really, really positive about it. The way he did it was really good. That's the second time he's had my back. He's got a great capacity to flip the script and make things. When I tell him something negative, he turns it all into a positive. Maybe like a super positive. He's got some sort of capacity to do that. And I told him, man, you know, someday, you know, I'm going to have your back. You know, if you get into trouble, I'm going to have your back. That happened to me today. He's got a world beater mind somehow, but he may have trouble sometime. May have to bail him out at some point, because it's tough in this world. If you're not really grounded in the Dharma Kings, it's trouble. This world's trouble. is worse than trouble. It's hell. So I have met these Dharma kings face to face many times and experienced directly their friendship. What they're extending is the equality, spiritual equality of friendship to us. That's it. So I can easily, any moment, have gratitude towards all of them and feel the gratitude. Because this is what brings gratitude out of us, is when you realize they're not trying to spiritually enslave us at all. They're not trying to tell us that we're forever less than they are, and that we have to worship them and give our energy to them and work for them. But hey, it's you know, we're spiritualizing the world. No, they don't ever say I have to work for them. They could offer me, like, if you want to help me, I will offer you if you want. We'd love to have you, but you're completely free to do whatever you want to do. And it's in friendship. You're working for me in friendship. You know, it's friendship among equals. Now, pragmatically, they're more, you know, awake. They're awake to the super positive, their perfection, realize more, much more than I am. And I understand that. So it's not equal in that way in time, because I'm still honoring time to some extent. But as far as they tell me very clearly that once time evaporates and you give it up, which you will do soon, they say, we're equal. You will recognize our equality. You will absolutely recognize that. And that's what they crave. That's what they're all about, is getting every single one of us to recognize our equality. That's what they're all about. And so I recognize me, I'm still honoring time to some extent, so I'm not, maybe you say a Dharma prince, but I'm not Dharma king, no way. They're way, way, way above me. Way, 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 way above me. And, but it's not a problem for me. I cherish that. That's great. They don't exploit that. They don't exploit it. So it's a safe feeling for me. I have a safe feeling. And then gratitude comes out of that safe feeling in friendship. You know, they come in friendship and equality. But they also come in super positivity. Make no mistake about that. I cannot pull them down into positivity and say, hey, you know, if you just really, really the top positive, you know, if you're top positive, great, the greatest positive, you know, maybe that would work. Maybe that would help everybody. So maybe I tried to pull them into that. You can't pull them into it. You cannot. You cannot. They remain in super positivity. At all times, they remain in super positivity. And I tried to do that with Sri Sri Nandamayama. I said, look, if you could just be really positive, the greatest of positiveness, everybody would flock to you, and everybody would be saved. And I thought maybe that would work, but it doesn't work. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. It can never work. Again, positivity is the arrogant face, is the ugly face of arrogance. It's saying that we can change reality, because reality is only super positive. Reality is perfect. And what is perfect about our reality? Our perfect freedom. And that's all there is. So that's all. That's only that works. Nothing else works for us. Nothing else works. So you have to stay with the super positive. And of course we will struggle a bit, because we are still, you know, honoring time. When you honor time, you're honoring positivity. You're honoring your own arrogance. And that's, you know, face of that's positivity, ugly face of it. So we'll still be somewhat positive, and, you know, I still listen to the Beach Boys, say, oh, that's nice, it's great, you know, but the Dharma kings are all only super positive. And they give us an opportunity to get used to that. So we're about finished with this video. Yeah, I've been, you know, on a roll here, you know, obviously on a roll. Got to be, right? It's no time to be a shrinking violet right now. But the fear of God, hopefully I put the fear of God into, meaning the fear of positivity and how treacherous it is. It's quicksand. It's quicksand. So look out for the yoga girls. Hopefully Vajra Yogini can help you with that. And look out for the yoga guys, gals, you know, look out for that. There are a lot of yoga guys around too. Okay, really. So use, you know, your, you know, their lips are stinging nettles, you know. or whatever it will come to you, what some way to just give that shock of like, oh, that's hideous, so repulsive, so repulsive. Their muscles are icy cold snakes, slithery, slimy, icy cold snakes. You get the idea. It just, whatever just shocks your mind, really horrifies you. You say, oh my God, that is so hideous. It's so hideous, I just have to stay away. I can't, don't try to resolve it. No, I just got to stay away from that. So you're going to have to stay with the super positive, not with the positive. Positive is very tempting. We'll all be tempted by it. To some extent, we may get into it to some extent, but you got to back away from it. You got to get back into the super positive. Feel the gratitude towards the Dharma Kings. Feel the gratitude. They come in equality and friendship. And they have the skillful means to wake us up and to drop our continuity fear. They have the skillful means to do this. And they tell us we will do it. We will succeed. We've already succeeded. And their mind is a done deal. There's no failure in their mind. Well, the good news also is this will end pretty soon here. And I can go inside and it's where it's warm. it's getting chilly tonight. The nights have been balmy here. This is chilly. And I can have something to eat. I haven't really eaten that much today. Trying to get my weight down. Still hanging in there, close to my goal, but still not there. I keep falling away from it. So I'm still trying somehow to stick with it, abide in it. You don't want to be caught by the positivists. Out of shame, they say, oh, it's just that you don't think you can do the positive, that's why. And I can say, no, look, I could be easily positive now. I'm in great shape. You kidding me? I look great, feel great. I'm very confident. I could do the positive just as good as anybody, actually. I could, but I'm not doing it like as much as the way you want me to, because I'm doing the super positive. So it helps to say,